Good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2021. Our first item is consideration of the motion on the made affirmative instrument considered at last week's meeting. We are joined by Graeme Day, Minister of Transport, for this agenda item. Minister, I welcome you to the meeting. Would you like to make any further remarks on the made affirmative instrument before we take the motion?
Recognising the busy schedule the committee has, I'll leave it to that if that's okay. And just move the motion.
That's fine. I now invite them to move the motion. Has any members got any comments? No comments? Sorry, could you move the motion, please?
Move the motion.
Thank you. I note that no member has indicated that they wish to speak, so I'll now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M-02261 be agreed to. Do all members agree?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. The motion is agreed. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the statutory instrument considered at this meeting. I would like to thank the Minister for his attendance this morning. I will now suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Good morning. I now move on to agenda item number 2, which is an evidence session on the vaccination programme. I'd like to welcome to our first panel to the meeting, Eamon Hanny, General Manager of Central Scotland Regional Equality Council, Parveen Ishak, Office Manager for Edinburgh and Lothian's Regional Equality Council, Magda Zarnica, and apologies if I pronounce that incorrectly, Chief Executive Officer of Phoenix Counselling, Personal Development and Support Services, Maria Jose Pavez Laria, Policy Officer and Project Coordinator of Grampian Regional Equality Council, Mohammed Razak, Executive Director, West of Scotland Regional Equality Council, and Dr. Paulina Trevina, Research Associate in Urban Studies, University of Glasgow. Welcome and thank you for giving us your time this morning. We are the lead committee responsible for scrutinising the rollout of the vaccination programme. Today's session is an opportunity to consider why uptake of the available vaccines has been below average in some of the communities in Scotland. Our first panel will be speaking to us about the experience and perspective of ethnic minority communities. Each member will have approximately 8 minutes to speak to the panel and ask their questions. If you would like to respond to an issue being discussed, please type R in the chat box and we will bring you in. We have a large panel today and I'm keen to ensure that everyone gets an opportunity to speak. I apologise in advance, therefore, if time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interests of brevity. I will now turn to questions, and if I may begin by asking the first question. Thank you. We find ourselves again in this challenging situation with the new variant, and we know that vaccinations may not stop you catching the virus, but from evidence so far, vaccinations most definitely hinder the severity and reduces the need for hospitalisation. So to protect not only our communities but also our health service, we need people to take up the vaccines. We have representation today from 4 of Scotland's regional equality councils. And Eamon Hanny, I know you need to leave early today, so I'll ask you what challenges you have faced trying to get minority communities to take up the vaccination and what you believe the Scottish Government could be doing to give confidence to those minority groups to get vaccinated.
Thank you very much and good morning to everybody. I'll try and be as short and as quick as possible. There's a variety of factors. We deal with people from a wide range of different backgrounds, and that does not only include their ethnic backgrounds, but the intersectional, diverse nature of these people. But I'll try and summarise the most common reasons for why the people that we deal with, at least, have hesitancy or reluctance to uptake the vaccination when they're offered ones. Main one would come across to us as is the lack in trust in the NHS services or anything that's coming from an authority. And that's mainly because of the nature of where these people had come from. People who had either grown up in communism or, who are fleeing their countries because of war or, they've been oppressed in their own governments, often tend to see things that are coming from the government as against them. And that naturally creates that hesitance and resistance to taking anything that the government is telling you is not going to be for my benefit. And unfortunately, that's one big factor within many of the groups that we deal with. We've also got the other usual suspect, the myths and the misconceptions where people have, those misbeliefs about certain concepts of the vaccine. It's not been there for long enough. How do I know I'm not going to grow a third leg? How do I know I'm not being chipped? And you've got to understand that for certain people, refugees, asylum seekers, illegal migrants, people who are on zero-hour contracts, people who have got poverty, childcare barriers, all of these factors work together and make things harder for people to really want to take the opportunity of get the vaccine. We also have other resistance, because of personal experiences. you know, word of mouth, someone had it and they've had symptoms and afterwards and they weren't very well for a few days and they don't want to have a similar experience. On the other side of the coin is those who have no experience whatsoever. So they're in denial. I don't believe the whole COVID thing is real until I actually see it or experience it myself. There is a big variation of reasons why people from certain backgrounds really either reluctant or completely against having the vaccination. What can we do to overcome this? Plenty of things. Communication is key. We need to communicate with people in a way that is understandable to them, in a language they understand. And I don't just mean language as in the different languages we speak. I mean the approach itself. There are multiple grassroots organizations that have got existing relationships with people from ethnic minority backgrounds. We can use those existing relationships to build the trust and try and have the information delivered to these communities in an accurate manner, but also in a way that feels friendlier, not that it's coming from an authority. We have been participating within the Venus Ethnic Minority Nationalism Network, and there's been an awful lot of support through that network, and all of the resources were from the government, from the NHS, from Public Health Scotland. So it's all valid stuff, but we were using the resources from the government and the authorities, but delivering them through grassroots organizations, community groups, because that's easier and it just overcomes the whole trust barrier. I hope I've not taken too much time, but that's just a short summary of what's the situation like.
Great. Thank you very much, Iman. That's very, very interesting. I was just going to open it up to the Equality Council's Parveen, Maria or Mohammed. Did you want to come in on those points? I don't know if you can just raise your hand so I can see. No? Oh, sorry. Maria, would you like to come in, please?
Yes. Thank you very much for the invitation today. So just trying to summarize a few key points. We identified four main themes that were reasons for people not taking the vaccine or not accessing it. The first one, just as a summary, because I'm aware you have all the reports and you can see the details there. Just as a summary, the first theme is related mainly with vaccine information. The main issues there being uncertainty around the safety of the vaccines, as it was developed too quickly in comparison to others. And there's a longing for wanting more evidence to be collected. And the risk of developing blood clots related with the Oxford-AstraZeneca vaccine, concerns related to unknown long-term side effects especially, and concerns about impact on pregnancy and fertility paired with the lack of clear guidance when asking GPs and healthcare staff about it. Also related to what Iman was saying, there's a lack of trust also in public authorities and NHS and the information provided. And the perception also that once you had COVID, you are protected and you don't need the vaccine. And that was across all ages. In terms of practicalities, a second theme that's very important and is practical, so it can be addressed, is related to the vaccine appointments and people not receiving the letter, people receiving the letter at other addresses, miscommunication of appointments, misinformation or lack of information coming from local helplines related to where and when accessing where to access the vaccine, and also related to the support language available in vaccine centers. And of course, not understanding the letter due to language proficiency and the inability to self-register online, which I think takes relevance now because the main way that people are registering now for the vaccine is online. So that should be taken into account. And the third theme was vaccine hesitancy, as Iman said, low perception of risk, views against COVID-19 as it violates personal rights and freedom, and believing that the pandemic doesn't exist or is exaggerated. Fourth topic, other reasons, the lack of support networks when someone has recently arrived in a new city or in a new region in Scotland. And perhaps the side effects concerning the person and not having access to a network of support in that regard, and which is also important in terms of people that does have 0 hours contract or no recourse for public funds in their visa category. And of course, also some conflicts with personal beliefs and family conflicts because of different views around the vaccine. and how to tackle all these concerns and how to promote vaccination uptake, just as main topics. First of all, more information and resources about the vaccine are needed. Also, more information about the consequences of long COVID. More information and resources about incentives and positive consequences of receiving the COVID-19 vaccine. For example, including the booster in the vaccine certificate. I understand that it's currently not included. And just to summarize, continue to increase the number of community members that encourage others to get the vaccine, include faces from the communities in the promotional material, and increase flexibility in the access and information on the appointments as well. And I'm sorry if I was too long in that summary.
Thank you, Maria. No, that's much appreciated. I know that there's quite a few members of the panel that do want to come in, but I've also got John. You want to ask a question specifically to...
Well, it wasn't specifically, but I mean, generally, I mean, I'm just wondering, especially from the first, was it Eamon said about scepticism about governments and health and health services. So I think my question then would be, well, do we just have to accept that will take 20 or 30 years to overcome, or is there some quicker way of overcoming that? And secondly, I think it's been suggested before that some people get advice, and perhaps the Polish community, from Poland, and so they're hearing what the Polish health service is saying. I mean, is that actually an issue? So I'll leave it at that. Yep. Does Eamon want to come back in?
Yes, thank you very much. It's not a matter of, it's not going to take decades for people to overcome the issues of lack of trust in authorities. I think if we understand what the makeup of ethnic minorities is like and people who are living in disadvantaged situations, it's a complex matter. But there's nothing that is set in stone. There's always ways that we can work together with people and reassure them. It's just a matter of personal experiences. And these, in certain situations, at least with the communities that we deal with, these experiences have been going on for long enough to have left that much of a scar into the system and where and how they can accept things that come from the authorities, which is why, in my suggestion, I think and I believe that if we work together with existing organisations that already have got over the trust issue with these communities and work along with them rather than always having to come from the clinical perspective that would overcome that massive barrier. The other point you've asked was with the Polish communities. It's not just the Polish communities, it's the information. Many ethnic minority groups and the Polish communities are one of them, tend to have and rely on information from their own back home governments, authorities back home or relatives back home. And that's a common theme within many of the ethnic minority groups. And that's again, due to the nature of the trust and the relationship that they've got, I'll believe what my sister tells me more than I would believe someone that I'd complete utter a stranger. It's just how it works. It's not to say that we're not going to be able to deal with it. There are existing organisations, not just ourselves. There are many grassroots organisations that deal with ethnic minority groups, have got the relationship, have got the trust built up. I think it's just a matter of working together with other groups and with other organizations to deliver these informations, to deliver this reassurance and try and overcome that obstacle and help people to get vaccinated as soon as possible.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to, we do have a bit of time, so I'm going to move on to the rest of the panelists that want to comment, and then I'll move on to members' questions. Parveen, would you like to come in?
Yes. Hello, everyone. Good morning. I think I'm on. There we go. Good morning, everyone. I'm the manager from Edinburgh and Lothian's Regional Equality Council. I would agree with all the points Eamon has mentioned. They are exactly the reasons that we have also found. But if I speak specifically from a South Asian background, I would say the two main issues we've had regarding the vaccine uptake. One is, as you know, a lot of South Asian communities have long-term health issues, such as diabetes, hypertension, high blood pressure, many other things, and they're just not convinced that the vaccine will help them. In fact, it may deteriorate their health more because they've just not got enough information which tells them that it's safe for them to take it, and that it's not going to have any adverse side effects, knowing that they've got the long-term health issues. And the other thing is, we're more likely to get a better uptake of vaccines if it was coming directly from your own GP. So, for example, for the rest of the population, let's say under the age of 50, it's fine. But anybody with underlying health issues from these ethnic backgrounds, specifically South Asia, they would feel better if this information was coming from their own GP, who knows about their health issues and who knows, possible risks that they may have. So they're more likely to take the vaccine if it came from their GP. But I appreciate GPs are not able to, do this work. They're already, very busy and inundated. So I'm not sure if this is possible. But it goes back to the main issue of lack of trust in the government, and also how the vaccine's been rolled out. It's been a kind of one-size-fits-all approach, which they don't have any faith in. And then during the lockdown, it was a case of a lot of misinformation coming from different channels, from abroad. And we did try and do a small project during the lockdown to try and combat this. But like Iman said, people would rather believe somebody that they could relate to rather than just, the general message coming from the leaflets or from NHS Scotland saying, take your vaccine. But it doesn't say why they should take the vaccine, if it's safe for them and it's been tested enough on your ethnicity. So because of that, it's 99% safe. So they're the main things that we felt. And now recently what's coming up is a lot of people have already had the vaccine, have had COVID, they've recovered from it, and there isn't any major side effects of COVID, apart from maybe persistent cough or chest problems, which obviously the doctors have said it could take months to recover fully. So now the issue is people are thinking, well, if our bodies can deal with COVID or the flu or any other illness that comes up or any other virus comes up, then surely we can get over COVID as well. So why do we need to put the vaccine in our bodies when it's just a new vaccine? There's no guarantee that it's not going to give us adverse side effects. So it's not really worth putting in our bodies if we're recovering from it. So they're the main things that we've found over the last number of months.
Thank you very much, Parveen. Can I bring in Mohammed, please?
Very much. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Yes, Mohammed Razak from West Scotland Regional Equality Council and part of SAREC. I think a lot of issues have been mentioned already by my colleagues here, and I just want to maybe touch on a couple of more things and maybe in more detail about, we've talked about lack of trust, and I think it's not just about, previous governments, but even within the UK, you have discrimination, you've got an immigration issue, you've got hate crime, the way it's dealt, and the negative effect of Prevent programme, for instance, the Windrush scandal, and even now in the new Nationality and Borders Bill that can take away your nationality without you being notified. So these things do matter, along with what has been said already. And the information being, coming to ethnic minorities through social media, and I think my colleagues have mentioned about back home countries, which to be honest, that they have different cultural and environmental issues there than we have here. For instance, in most of Asia and Africa, people spend most of their outside their home. They don't sit inside offices or sit within their home. It's an outside environment. So the spread of the virus is not as much, and people don't take it as an important thing. So, and also they're getting social media from other countries, which is telling them a different story. So who do they believe? And also one thing that's not mentioned is the faith related issues. Certainly within Islam, if you it is very clear that it is God that decides if you live and die. You know, some followers, in particular the elderly, will say, well, if this is already decided, why take the vaccine? If it's up to God, why should we take it? So there is some element of that as well, and need to adhere to that. And one of the things that maybe not mentioned as well is about ethnic minorities having larger families. So if you've got a head of the family that is anti-vaxxer, then you've got a large number of people that will not take the vaccine because of that. So as you go along, the numbers become bigger and bigger. And similarly, word of mouth is huge in these communities. And therefore, any one anti-vaxxer could actually put out their information to others, and quickly, before you know it, you've got a lot more that are taking up that, message of anti-vaccine. So there's that issues that we don't actually take into account. And of course, they're close-knit communities, as you know, and therefore, you know, the message gets out there much, much quicker. The other thing I wanted to mention is, in the early days of COVID, we had some consultation with government, and we said there wasn't enough role models, information going out to ethnic minorities. And I'm pleased that within a couple of months, there was a lot of information coming from the Scottish Government, the NHS, with role models giving their views about vaccine. And that was having a positive effect for us anyway. As an organisation, we were able to send this out to all our client groups and partners. And I thought we were winning the battle in terms of getting that message across about getting the vaccine. But that stopped after a few months, and now there's nothing going out. And I don't know whether the government thinks the job is done and we've crossed that, you know, line, but it feels it hasn't. And I was thinking it may have, because there was nothing coming out from the government. Now I realise that it's still an issue. So, you know, why did we stop? There's nothing coming out at all at the moment. And I'm sure my colleagues will agree with that. And just like a colleague said about, you know, the whole stigma about, you know, communications, sharing that information, making people aware, along with religious and cultural needs. It's not just about the vaccine itself. What does each religion has to say in terms of vaccines and whether you should take it or not? And I think we need to get role models from various religious groups saying, you know, this is okay. And all this what happened earlier on, it did happen, but it stopped all of a sudden. And it's just, I think, continuing that would help quite a lot. So that was the main things I would say from my point of view. And we were very, very happy to actually liaise with the government and NHS, bring those information and pass it on to our communities. But sadly, that is stopped.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dusty.
Thank you, Mohammed. I think you raised some very, very valid points and interesting points there. I know that there's a few more panellists wishing to come in, but I am going to pass over to my colleague, Murdo Fraser, to ask a question, and he will bring you in. Thank you.
Thank you, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if I could put this question, first of all, to Magda from Phoenix. I'm interested to get your views on what's already been said, but I know that if we look at the numbers, there's a particular issue in the Polish community with a lack of uptake of vaccinations. We've heard from other contributors that there is an issue with suspicion of government. I'm interested to get your thoughts on that too, if that's a driving factor. One of the things that we've seen develop just in the last few weeks in other parts of Europe is a tightening of restrictions, particularly on the unvaccinated. So some countries have brought in lockdowns for unvaccinated people. There's been a conversation in some countries about making vaccinations compulsory. And we haven't gone anywhere close to that here, but we have seen vaccine passports here in Scotland and then, you know, elsewhere in the UK. So I'm interested to get your perspectives on whether that sort of approach is likely to encourage people to be vaccinated, or might it actually have the opposite effect? So Magda, first of all, please.
Hi, thank you for inviting me. To refer to what was already said, I think the vaccine hesitancy within the Polish community was already quite well known even before COVID appeared. And we were, as Phoenix, we were working with NHS Slovian on a few research with Dr. Dermot Gorman on understanding why that was happening. And it proved that main anti-vaccine movement was coming from Poland. And then I'm not sure if there was anything we were able to do about that. But there is, I think, what is important to highlight that was the missed opportunities from the government and from the other institutions, that until our campaign that started in June, there was no real outreach to the ethnic minorities coming from the government. And for it pretty much was 1 year since the lockdown that all those anti-vaccine and conspiracy theories managed to develop in Scotland. We as Phoenix, we were trying to do as much as possible. We are translating information about information about the change, ever-changing conditions and of social distancing. But I don't think we had the strength to combat all the myths that were developing on social media, because since Facebook, for instance, is one of the main channels used over lockdown to communicate. And I have to say that I think there was a lot of missed opportunities. And another aspect was, I think there were materials translated to Polish and other languages that are available, for instance, on NHS Inform, that are pretty much not searchable, in a sense that all the files are titled in English. So they say, whatever, vaccine information, Polish. There are in PDFs, and there are on NHS Inform. So pretty much if you're looking in Polish, vaccine, COVID, Scotland or Edinburgh, it's not coming up. So all the information that was created, and whether there were videos or there were leaflets, that are pretty much not searchable. So they are not, for the person who is not using English very well, they were looking for information in Polish, they were not finding it. So I think it has to be understood that it was pretty much a kind of information gap for 1 year, at least. So with our, and all the information was coming from Poland. So that's also an issue we found, that I think it was called Ryanair Medicine even before. So people were choosing the modality of medicine that was fitting them. Yes, and the lack of trust to the authorities, to the system, I think was also exacerbated in this situation, because there was no communication with the Polish community. So pretty much people felt that they were left by themselves and they had to make choices, decisions by themselves. And if there was no information, they were making decisions that way. Colleagues before said that it's important to give information, but what has to be understood, the information has to be a lot more in-depth than for the local community. And this has to be explaining all the ways how people have to how to register for the GP, for the vaccination, and how to why the vaccination is actually important, and to address the doubts that people have. And I think whatever came up during our campaign was that quite a lot of people really wanted this personal conversation with a specialist, like with a GP, to be able to discuss their health issues, which they didn't have. They didn't have this opportunity, and with that was coming also the problem of having a choice between the vaccinations. Scotland was very strong on AstraZeneca for a very long time, whereas Poland, for instance, already gave access to Pfizer or Moderna, which was a choice, was giving a little bit more trust to the system.
Okay, thanks. Thank you very much, Magda. Can I ask you just briefly the second question I asked you about whether making vaccines compulsory or making it harder for people to be unvaccinated, would that help or would that make matters worse?
I am in two minds about that. So it's very difficult to say. I think if people have economical incentive of any kind, then probably they will get vaccinated. Economical, not in being paid, but having limited access to places and to work, then probably a big part would get vaccinated. We found that there was a vast group of users which we'd call late adopters, possibly, that they were looking and trying to understand what's happening and what are the effects of vaccination, and possibly they are now a bit suffering with COVID or not. So it's a difficult question. There's no specific answer to it.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to bring in Dr. Paulina Trevena, who we've not heard from so far. Paulina, can I just get your reflections on the discussion that we've just heard in general terms, but also maybe specifically on the question I asked around whether making vaccines compulsory or bringing in more restrictions on the unvaccinated actually encourages people to take up the vaccine, or does it have the opposite effect?
Good morning. So I think let me address this question first. I think that would cause a lot of polarization. So basically, some people would be encouraged, some people would be very, very discouraged. And I think there's actually been some research done on that. There's an LSE blog that you can have a look at, which actually shows that is what would happen. And during COVID, I worked on a research project on Polish essential workers in the UK, and vaccination was one of the things that we discussed. And basically, the same thing comes across from our research, that some people are very much against it. And, you know, there's a lot of mistrust towards NHS or the government. And if these people are told that it's obligatory, they will, I think, go even further down the conspiracy theory road, basically, while other people said, well, if it's made compulsory, then I'll get vaccinated. And I have to say travel is a big motivator. Being able to travel freely, being able to travel without tests, or just being able to travel because, for a lot of Poles, it's very important, not because they just love traveling, but because they have families abroad. And it's a big thing not being able to see your family. So many people mentioned that that was a big, big difficulty for them traveling during COVID. And for example, if traveling was made more difficult because they're not vaccinated, then they would consider vaccination. But I also wanted to reiterate all the points that Magda Czarnecka made. And because I think one of the biggest problems with encouraging people to get vaccinated is the fear of the vaccines not being trialed properly, not safe, of the side effects. But also, I was quite taken aback by the fact that a lot of our interviewees didn't see any medical benefits to being vaccinated. So they were of the view that it doesn't really fully protect them and it doesn't help protect anybody else. And some people were kind of sitting on the fence and saying, well, once we see how the vaccination program proceeds, if there is proof that it actually works, then I'll consider. And I think I cannot underline enough how important it is to get out messaging which is reliable and unbiased. And we've already mentioned that a lot of people use sources from abroad. And one of the reasons is because they're used to it, but another reason is the language barrier in accessing reliable sources locally. So Magda already mentioned things like documents not being searchable in Polish, for example. And really, for people who are not entirely proficient in English, there weren't any reliable sources of information. And that's why they were turning to information from the home countries, basically. And as Magda and other people said, the problem with that is that in Poland, there's a very strong anti-vaccination movement, and there was a lot of influence from that movement. And I think one important thing to mention also in terms of getting information out is not just having reliable sources, but how you actually spread the information. And for example, Magda also picked up on this, that Facebook, social media are a big, big thing for Poles living in the UK. It's a big source of information, very often used. There are a lot of Facebook groups, conspiracy groups and so on, which were spreading all this false information, basically. And I just wanted to say that, for example, when we were doing our study under COVID, we were recruiting people via Facebook for our survey polls, and we did targeted Facebook advertising, and we were really, really taken aback by how many people responded. So we have over 1,100 responses to our survey. And the reason I'm saying this is because I'm just trying to underline that if you place information in social media or through social media advertising, that might be a more effective way of actually getting it out than just having it somewhere on official websites. And if I may, I'd just like to make one more point, and this is maybe specifically about the Polish community and practical barriers to vaccination. And what is characteristic of the Polish community is that they have a very, very high employment rate. So a lot of people are in employment, but it's often low paid employment in low skilled sectors. And the practical barriers people are coming across is taking time off work, for example, because a lot of people are in precarious employment, working on zero contracts or for agencies. And these people, if they're not working, they lose income. And there's a lot of people who live in poverty, basically, or very close to the poverty line, live from paycheck to paycheck. This is a big thing for people. This is a big barrier. And I think it would be good to consider how the Scottish government can, or Scottish Parliament can support people in employment, in precarious employment, in actually getting the vaccine. And it's all, you know, other people also mentioned lack of support networks. This is also a problem in terms of if you have side effects, what do you do? If you can't go to work, if you're not being paid, and what do you do with your children and so on? So apologies if that was a bit long, but I just wanted to reiterate a few more points.
Thank you. I'll move on to Jim Fairley, please.
Thank you, convener. I want to direct my questions to two people specifically. Iman, I'm going to ask you first. You said about you need grassroots organisations to deliver the message into these communities. We've sat in this committee before and been told that that's already happening. Are you telling us that it's not?
It is happening, but it's not happening as much as it can be happening. And I think it's because of more than one reason. One of them is that sometimes grassroots organizations are getting mixed messages. I have personally been told you're not allowed to give information sessions. We have delivered information sessions, by the way, to ethnic minority groups. But I have been told by somebody, there was an initial resistance being told it has to come from the NHS. You have to be a registered doctor with the NHS to deliver the information, which I know is not exactly the case. So, but there is there are mixed messages that we're getting. Community groups, organisations, we're an equalities and human rights organisation, but we had all our resources from the NHS and Public Health Scotland. We weren't giving information out of nowhere. But you do get some resistance because of mixed messages or confusions sometimes. So it is happening, but not as well as it should be.
Thank you. That is something that we can put to the government. Mohammed, I was also going to come back to yourself. You gave a similar kind of a message. But one of the things that did catch my attention in what you were saying is that there are certainly some of the older Islamic, some of the older people in the Islamic faith who believe that if it's God's will, then it will happen. Now, please forgive my ignorance of your faith, because I really don't know enough about it. But is there not also a message in Islam that would say that we look after each other and that the vaccine is part of that process?
Yes. No, you're absolutely right that there is. However, that message has to go. The message has to go, and that's what I meant about trusted people, whether that's from the religious fraternity or the government saying, you know, or people who are role models who say that's the message. So somebody has to get the message out. Yes, we can put the message out, but it has to be produced by a relevant organisation in the first hand, just as Iman has said. People will not trust just us as an organisation, which is a non-religious organisation, for West of Scotland Regional Equality Council itself. But it needs to be a religious or organisation that produces these things, or produced through the government from a religious perspective, and then sent that out. So that message has to go out. I totally, absolutely, you know, that there is the other bit in religion is you have to look after yourself. God has given you this life and you have to look after yourself. So that's another message. But then again, how do you pull that together? And how do you, that obviously, you know, organizations like ourselves can put the message out because we're nearer the communities. We know where to go. We can do all that. But we need somebody to pull it together that has the confidence of the community. So it, either it's a role model or it has to come from the religious fraternity, get that message across.
Okay. I attended a Sikh women's event very recently, and one of the phrases that they kept coming up with, again, it's a new phrase to me, that they live in a very gendered society. And Mahat, you talked about having one head of the family who could be anti-vax in his thinking, and that would then determine how a whole family would react. Can you expand on that? And is there a way of finding out where this is happening?
We lost
Sorry,
connection?
We can't hear anything.
Sorry, can you hear us now? Sorry, I think we temporarily lost connection. Can you hear us now? Yes? Okay.
Yep.
Did you hear Jim's question? No. Jim, would you like to say the question again, please?
Okay. Mohammed, I'm sorry, I'm sticking with yourself. I recently attended a Sikh women's organisation a briefing session, and they talked about a very gendered society, which I didn't understand what they meant until they explained it. And you also talked about the head of a family, of a very large family, could end up influencing the entire family. How do we get to those individuals in order to be able to get this vaccine into more arms?
I think I've explained that just now in terms of getting role models. And if it's a religious aspect, then you have to get somebody religious within the community, whether there is an imam of a mosque or you've got Muslim Council of Scotland. They've got members that could get that message out, you know, in terms of either it's a video or in certain languages that we can actually then pass on to our community. But somebody, as I said, has to take the lead in making that, and whether that's the government or NHS. As I said earlier, in the early days, I think mid last year, about June, July, there was a number of things that very good things that came out in terms of passing that message across, and we did as an organisation, but nothing new's come back from the government since then. So it's only, I think it was 3 to 4 months, there was quite a number of different things that came through, very, very, you know, pro-vaccine information from role models and so forth, but that stopped.
Okay.
In terms of coming through, no new material came through that we could send out, because things are changing all the time. So the same message a year ago will not be relevant now. So okay. It's about how do you change that message so we can then pass it on. And again, if it's faith related, it has to be somebody from the faith, whether it's Christian or whether, you know, whichever religion that may be. But, you know, ethnic minorities are not all from Islam or, you know, one religion. They're from all different religions, Christianity, Buddhist, everything. So each religion has to be represented to make sure that all the community get the message.
I'm literally just trying to focus on how we get the message to each individual group, which is why I've come to yourself and Iman. We've heard very clearly from Paulina about Facebook and social media. So the point I'm making is to the clerks and to this committee that we need to focus on where the messages need to come from. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. Can I move to Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, Kavira. Good morning. I was interested around this, the term of vaccine hesitancy, and I wondered whether within that vaccine hesitancy there's almost an inertia, if you like, whether it's perceived almost it's too difficult to access the vaccine or travel to the vaccine. And I'm wondering, as an extension of the conversation we've had so far, do we need to be taking the vaccine to the public, to these to the ethnic minority groups, rather than waiting for them to come to the vaccine, for want of a better expression? And the behavioural difference that is, because obviously we've talked about social media, we've talked about the fake news, we've talked about how the people are accessing their information. Do we really need to be almost more proactive in going into the communities, taking the vaccine into the communities? And do we have Dr. Kerry Lunan with us at all? Do we have? No? No? Sorry, I've got the wrong one. In that case, can I ask Magda, please?
Yes, I think we found that the proactive approach is very important to address the hesitancy, and it can be done in many ways. We were thinking of the buses, getting closer, being more available, and getting closer to in the rural areas. But I think it would be great if Maria Jose Paves could say a little bit about their project that they had in Breck, about the community navigators or health champions they had. Because I think this personal approach of having a conversation within community with the health champions who would be able to speak, trained enough, well enough to be able to speak about the vaccinations, that this personal contact would be probably best. The more proactive approach is definitely welcome.
Thank you. Maria, would you like to come in?
Yes, I completely agree with what Magda said there. Facilitating access and flexibilizing the access to the vaccines is really key. Community vaccination clinics in, for example, churches, mosques, have been really good at a local level. The possibility of also going to those clinics without an appointment allows the whole family to go together. So it also increases the conversations within the family with a healthcare specialist. And those are the sources of information that are trusted, the healthcare staff. So I think these conversations have to be prompted. Community clinics are a way of doing it, and also showing that staff trust the vaccinations, not only in the clinics, but in all healthcare settings. It's really important. As I mentioned, some pregnant women that were seeking for advice regarding the vaccine, that were asking the midwives and other GPs, didn't find the reassurance that they were looking for. So in that regard, those are the most trusted sources of information. What Magda mentioned about community health champions, we've been working with that structure to approach community members, and it has been really positive, creating those one-to-one conversations with also members of the community. Members of the community want to see themselves also represented in the informational material that's out there. And just to add to something mentioned before, yes, the resources translated are not too friendly at the moment, but also it's the format. I think a lot of members in our communities have been asking for more resources that are in a video format, dubbed or with subtitles, or even coming straight from their community members in their language. So that would be another way of reaching people farther. And just also wanted to make allusion to a question that was mentioned before about making the vaccines compulsory. We had people saying we will not get the vaccine until they are compulsory, but I really think it's important to follow all steps in terms of communication efforts before that to reach the communities before making a decision of that sort.
Thank you. And briefly, I think Mohammed, you wanted to make a comment.
Yeah, thank you. Just speaking about, you know, bringing the vaccine to the people, an excellent idea. And I think we had some of that in Glasgow, at Glasgow Central Mosque. And I think that encouraged a lot of people. But I think that the powers to be, that Central Mosque was the only one mosque in Glasgow, for instance. There's 22 others. And normally people go to one, just like, you know, and similarly, where there are some number of churches where most Polish people will go to, or other minority, there is churches that where ethnic minorities from South Asia would go to. It's about pinpointing those and having these vaccination centres in there. However, some might not be large enough for that, but you could have mobile vaccination centres outside, and particularly for mosques, it's a Friday, and maybe, you know, for other faith groups, it might be Sunday. The Sikh community is a Sunday. I think some churches is a Sunday. So it's about getting that information. We have to go to the people. You know, we have to find out that information and not sit back and saying, we've sent out a message and people will get to it. So I think getting to people is very important. That's just the religious aspect. Then you, as I think some people have mentioned about where most of communities work. I mean, a lot of shopkeepers, for instance, work, in different communities, but they all go and buy their stuff from one cash and carry, for instance. How about having a mobile van out there? And it only takes a couple of minutes to get vaccinated. We just have to go to the communities. And I think that's one thing that hasn't really happened apart from Glasgow Central Mosque. I think it was a very good idea, whoever came up with it. And I think that needs to be extended. If you want to catch everybody, it needs to be extended. And I think one of the things that within South Asian communities, that there was something about, you know, women being separated. And I think that there needs to be a look at how do you, women don't go to mosque, for instance. So therefore, how do we capture women in terms of, is there groups that come together locally? I think local organizations like ourselves give you that information in terms of where local women, there's elderly care centres, you know, for minority communities, in particular in Glasgow. Why not set up
Thank you, Mohammed. I'm just conscious of time because we've got to stop by 10:30, but could we move on to John Mason, please?
Is Alec not wanting in first? Or
Alec, are you wanting to come in?
Yeah, thank you. I would pick up on the point that Brian made there. I mean, the fact is that we know that our health service is overrun. People struggle to be able to get appointments with GPs. So there is limited ability for to extend the health service into communities. But one of the suggestions that has been made is that as long as there's a doctor or a nurse overseeing vaccination, that more people can be trained up. And we can actually support local organisations to organise vaccine delivery. Is that something that members of the panel think that should happen, where we actually engage and involve the local community, not just in encouraging people to take up vaccine, but actually in delivering the vaccine?
Alex, do you want to direct it to someone in particular?
Well, I can't really see if you hear anybody else. So I can now. Yeah. Magda, we'll start with you.
To be honest, it's very it's a surprising idea, and that would have to come with additional resources for our staff, or even employing a new member of staff, because at the moment we are pretty much dealing with other impacts of COVID on Polish community. We have massive increase in requests for emergency appointments, and there's nothing that we have a free capacity to deliver. So it sounds like a very innovative idea, but it didn't have to come with resources.
Okay. Dr. Polina?
Yes, thank you. I mean, I also think it's a good idea because so if you have people from the community and people from the community who are trained to deliver the vaccine, who can actually explain, you know, the advantages or possible side effects, I think that would really build trust. And throughout our study, you know, we've interviewed a number of, I don't know, nurses, for example, who deal with people who advocate for the vaccine just on their own kind of personal initiative. But I do think that in terms of building trust, giving access to information, but at the same time, I have to underline unbiased information, but just really reliable information and being able to vaccinate there and then, I think that would be a good idea. And if I can just touch on the idea that was raised earlier about bringing the vaccine to the people, again, I think I tried to underline that a lot of people of Polish origin, for example, are in employment, work long hours. If there were these vaccine buses that could be brought either nearer to the workplaces, sometimes you have workplaces where you have, you know, 1,000 or more people who are migrants, basically, or to the areas where they live, I think that would also support, you know, it would make it easier for people to get vaccinated. I think it would be a good mix.
Thank you. So I think, you know, we as a committee, I think it's important we go back, not just with outlining all the concerns that the anti-vaxxers and the levels of misinformation is creating, but we have to go back and start to put forward some positive ideas. So do we need more resources, community organisations? Maria, would you perhaps pick that up?
Yes, in terms of supporting community organisations, it needs to be done, and also to point out that the pandemic is ongoing, so the communication efforts have to be ongoing and the work with the communities has to continue. It can be like we work on this already for a year and it should be like done by now. It's going to take time, not 20 years perhaps, but it's going to take time and we have to continue to work with the communities. And as I said, like follow all the steps in communication and conversations that we can prompt to support the vaccination effort. There's also a big number of health staff from minority communities. So liaising through them can also be an option and then seeing how many community members can be interested in participating in something more concrete like the idea that you mentioned.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Can I please move on to John Mason?
Hey, thanks, convener. Getting a second shot today, that's nice. Can I ask about the Vaccine Information Fund, which I think has been administered by BEMIS, which is what, Black and Ethnic Minority Information Service. I think a couple of you have had experience of using that fund. So it kind of, this follows on from Alec Rowley's point about funding. I mean, some things you've asked for today, I think the NHS have probably need to do or the government needs to do. But I mean, if you had a bit more funds or have you tried applying to these funds so you could do more yourselves? Open to Parveen, you haven't said anything recently.
Hi. I can't remember if it was the BEMIS grant, but we did get a small grant of, I think it was £500. But that was only to disseminate some vaccine information, as in, you know, general information that you should get vaccinated and how to do it. This was during the lockdown, but since then we haven't, you know, had anything else after that. But I think we're at that stage now where it's not just about getting the information out there in different languages. People have different concerns now, and the concerns are mainly around the vaccine and how effective it is in general, and also how and if any impact it will have on them based on the fact that they have underlying health issues. So it's different. It's different issues now to what there was during the lockdown. So I think going back to the other question about resources and getting the community involved, I think that's a great idea, and it would definitely work. But again, everything needs resources, and getting more digital, getting more, community champions doing this work, whether it's, it doesn't need to be vaccinating the community, it could purely be assisting the health professionals in, getting to the communities and, helping with translation, any issues people have, and getting over all these barriers. So it goes back to the question about working together. But yes, I would agree that we really do need to get into the communities and try and get rid of some of these barriers and myths that people have. But then we also need to differentiate between anti-vaxxers and people who generally don't want to have the vaccine for just, general reasons that they don't take medicine, or they would rather have a more holistic approach. So I think during the whole conversation, we've discussed more about how to get, BME communities vaccinated. But then same with the Scottish population, we're not going to have 100%, communities taking up the vaccine, because everyone or there will be, people who are not anti-vaxxers, but they do believe that, they would rather deal with the COVID in a more holistic approach than get the vaccine. So we need to differentiate between that.
OK, that's helpful. Thanks very much. Mohamed Razak, did you want to come in as well?
Think about the idea of local organisations helping. I think it's a wonderful idea and it would work. However, just like everybody else, it will require resources to be put forward. Your question about Bemis, we were one of the organisations did apply for that, and it was, as Parveen said, I think it was £1,000 maximum you could get. And we did apply and we got it, and it was for, I think, 3 months or 4 months of work about just passing on the information about vaccine. And it wasn't anything, bigger than that, to be honest. And £1,000 doesn't take you far, to be honest. What you need is a bit more longer term thinking about having projects that will go the whole year, maybe in terms of various different things, getting the information out, maybe getting more volunteers that would volunteer with the health service and so forth. So it needs to be something thought out bigger than the £1,000. It needs to be something worthwhile for organisations to do.
Okay. I get your point that there's probably a long-term question here and also a short-term question. So I take your point, long-term, we maybe need to do more. Do you think in the short term it would be worth repeating, even if it was only £1,000 again?
I think, yes, it would be, but I think it would need to be coupled with resources, fresh resources that are available. Yes, we can make certain amount of resources ourselves, but it has to be coming from the Scottish Government or the NHS in terms of resources, bilingual material or, videos and things like that, that we can then pass out. I think the £1,000 would be helpful to reinvigorate what we've done last year along with other organisations. But I think the longer term would need to be substantial.
I think we're just about to run out of time, but Magda, did you want to say something as well?
Yes, we were also funded by, we received this one, £1,000 from Venus, from the vaccination fund. The work that we've done, we calculated it was worth at least £6,000. And it was over 3 months. And it's that we did the what was necessary at the time. So we organized meetings with the specialist Jason Leach, for instance, and also specialists from Oxford University. However, and created a guide to vaccination that is now available on our website, and also the biggest issue I think was that all of a sudden we were invited to communicate with the PHS and Scottish Government and the Parliament. And I think because we were the only organisation reaching out to the Polish community, all of a sudden we were invited to all those conversations that were happening in the background. And we didn't expect that when we were applying for this grant. And that's why the amount of engagement that we had to put into this work was a lot more than we expected. So it was to produce maybe materials and extend them further, but the unexpected engagement took put a lot more work into this. And
Yeah.
Okay, well, we'll take that on board. Yeah, we'll make a note. Okay, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. We are now out of time, so I'd like to thank all the witnesses for their evidence and giving us their time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you about how to do this. So thank you very much, and I suspend the meeting. Thank you. Program, and I'd like to welcome our second panel to the meeting this morning. Hilda Campbell, Chief Executive of COPE Scotland, Dr. Kerry Lunan, GP from Craig Miller Medical Group and Chair of the Scottish Deep End Project, Derek Holliday, Peer Development Lead, Homeless Network Scotland, Dr. Andrea Williamson, the Scottish Deep End Project, Professor Neil Quinn, Professor of Social Work and Public Health and Co-Director of the Centre for Health Policy, University of Strathclyde. Thank you for giving us your time this morning, and welcome. As I explained to our earlier panel, we are the lead committee responsible for scrutinising the rollout of the vaccination programme. Today's session is an opportunity to consider why uptake of the available vaccines has been below average in some of the communities in Scotland. In this panel, we will discuss the vaccination uptake in communities experiencing higher levels of deprivation according to the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation. Each member should have approximately 8 minutes to speak to the panel and ask their questions. If you'd like to respond to an issue being discussed, please type R in the chat box and we will bring you in. We do have a large panel today, and I'm keen to ensure that everybody gets an opportunity to speak. And I apologise there in advance. If time runs on too much, I might have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interest of brevity. I'll now turn to questions, if I may begin. If I can ask Hilda Campbell from COPE Scotland, firstly, thank you for the extensive briefing that you provided to members, highlighting lots of the issues why vaccinations may not be taken up. One point that I thought was interesting, we all know about the misinformation and the scaremongering regarding vaccinations. And when you pointed out that when there was a broadcast on the BBC regarding recent queues for vaccines and one person was waiting for 45 minutes and said it was worth it because it was saving lives, so I can't agree enough with that comment. Your comment was perhaps more work needs to be done to praise those who are taking the vaccine and recognise their contribution to helping us move out of the pandemic. Can I ask Hilda, what should the Scottish Government be doing further to increase vaccine uptake in the minority groups from the more deprived areas where perhaps living day to day is more important than getting the vaccine?
Thanks very much, and thanks for inviting me along. Yes, I won't go over all the points in the report that I sent in, and I think many of it resonates with what the speakers were saying earlier around lack of trust, zero contracts, which peers people are seeking information from. But I do think that there is some need for using almost an appreciative inquiry, which is building on what works. So I had sent an image in as well. Someone had taken, they were in a queue for 2 hours to get their vaccine, but they stood in that queue. But a simple thing like being given a banana or a hot drink would have encouraged people perhaps who actually left the queue because they were just too cold. So there's some real practical things about celebrating the fact that actually there are a lot of people coming forward. And to gather that information, I had spoken to, and it's anecdotal, but I had spoken to a variety of colleagues around the experiences they had with people they were working with, as well as community leaders and others. And what I would say was that it wasn't uniquely people who are facing inequalities that weren't taking the vaccine. There were some professionals who were choosing not to take the vaccine. And for whatever reasons, they felt that it wasn't right for them. They weren't sure if enough research had been done. And what was interesting, I noticed that people who are vaccinated, when someone asks them a question about whether or not they should get vaccinated, they're usually pretty positive about it. Whereas someone who themselves have not been vaccinated, if someone asks their opinion, they're more likely to say, well, I'm not really qualified to tell you, you should go back and ask your GP. And what one local support worker had said was that they recognise GPs don't have the time to reassure everyone about the vaccination. And if they'd had more helpful information, they could have given that reassurance themselves. And that, again, resonated with the speakers earlier. So I think one of the things that perhaps Scottish Government can do is to find ways, instead of Jason Leach, and no harm to Jason Leach, but a lot of people won't identify with Jason, is to have people working with the communities to actually make up some not just videos that go around little halls and things, but actually go on the television, because that's what people watch. You know, if you get it on the television at peak time viewing, where that's real people that people identify with, and they're saying the benefits that they've had for the vaccine, then that's maybe one of the steps that can go forward. I also noticed the conversations about, do we make it mandatory now? We've got a Twitter account, so when I was doing some tweeting this morning, I noticed that there's quite a scary trend going on, which is we will not comply. And I don't want to get into the whole party business in this, because I'm only raising it as things like that don't help. So when the public see something which they view as unfair, their kickback to that can be, well, clearly there can't be such a problem, because if there was a problem, they wouldn't all have been partying. The fact they were partying, they know something we don't. And whatever people's view on the whole party gate is, the fact that we will not comply is trending on Twitter. And I had a quick scan through, because I knew it was coming on to this today, and a lot of that is, I won't be taking the vaccine. So there is something about role models and who people perceive as someone to be trusted. So tapping into lived experience panels, and there's a lot of good work the Scottish Government's doing through lived experience panels, through gambling harms, through suicide awareness and many more, is maybe inviting and saying, could you give us a hand to put together some materials that can go out and actually offer some credibility. Govern Youth Project did an amazing piece of work around gambling harms. I'm quite sure if they were approached to ask if young people would be willing to work with them on an animation even around young people's anxieties about gambling harms, so something could be done to overcome, would be really valued. There's a lot of questions asked. So why did people go for the vaccine? And consequences was one reason. So people felt pressurised by work to take it or pressure from the government. Now, the other day there, I received a communication from Glasgow Council Voluntary Services, because we're on their HR contract, and it's a template for a vaccine policy in the workplace. Now, we already have all that in place, so it was fine. There was nothing there that was new to us. But for others, it did give them something to think about. So actually, in the workplace, beginning to have vaccine policies, training on vaccine, looking at staff attitudes, volunteer attitudes to vaccines, there is a lot of information. I heard a question, is there not information going out? It's information overload. We get the public bulletin, it's dry reading. It's no pictures, no images, no cheery things. It's just a lot of text in Times New Roman. And when you're busy reading 101 other things, you're not cutting to the chase. We were fortunate that we worked with Jackie Sneddon from the Scottish Antimicrobial Prescribing Group to put together a tip sheet on antibiotic resistance to help raise awareness with the public about the role of antibiotics and not to demand an antibiotic when it's not appropriate, and also how to prevent infection. And although that's not directly related to COVID, I mentioned that, and I'm happy to send a copy of that in to let you see it. It's a very simple, basic tip sheet.
Sorry, Hilda, I'm just really conscious of time and I've used up my question time, so I'm going to have to move on to Murdo Fraser now. Thank you.
Yeah, no probs.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I might maybe just get a chance to bring some others in. I'll maybe start, who will I pick on? Professor Quinn, maybe. Pick on Professor Quinn. And just, I'm really interested to get your thoughts in particular on this question of vaccine hesitancy and people's distrust of government that we were discussing earlier and that Hilda just touched on. You know, there is this conversation about making vaccines compulsory, or at least as other countries have done, you know, bringing additional restrictions on the unvaccinated. And I'm interested to get your thoughts on whether that's something that's helpful or whether that might be counterproductive.
Thank you for inviting me to be part of the panel this morning. I was going to talk about our research with excluded communities and our research, which Derek Holliday was also involved in, looked at the experiences of a number of excluded groups in relation to accessing services more generally. So we didn't focus on vaccine take-up, but I think there's lessons from that that are helpful for this committee. So we spoke to people with experience of homelessness, with poor mental health, with refugees, asylum seekers, and women facing commercial sexual exploitation. And I guess some of the key lessons there were around the barriers that existed to people accessing health services, which seems to have worsened during the pandemic. So people described services being limited, withdrawn, or having less face-to-face supervision. And this impacted on people's ability to access the services and support they require. And also, many respondents felt that statutory services were inaccessible during lockdown. And also the issues of poor communication. So I think there are, particularly for excluded communities, issues of trust, issues of barriers to access. And I guess that flows through onto some of the problems around vaccine take-up. So I think perhaps as a first step, trying to remove some of those barriers to access, I think, are important. I suppose in relation to your question about compulsory vaccination, I think there's obviously pros and cons around this. I think it's we obviously need to increase vaccine rollout, whether we should go down the role of making that compulsory. I think we'd have to look at evidence from other settings and other countries as to whether that's deemed appropriate. But I think as a first step, I think trying to remove barriers to certain communities being excluded would be a first step, I think.
Okay, thank you very much. Could I maybe bring in Dr. Kerry Lunan just to get some general observations and then some thoughts on the specific question?
Yep, good morning. Thank you. Good to be here. I suppose some general observations are that the findings that we've had with the COVID vaccine rollout findings that we've had in all vaccine rollouts. So there's lots to learn from previous vaccination campaigns, in the uptake tends to be lower in certain groups, which is, I guess, why we're having these conversations today. We've talked a little bit about trust issues, and I think that does come across quite strongly. And I think that people are generally feeling a bit more disconnected in the world at the moment, which has probably not helped. And also there are issues of whether governments are able to have moral authority on being able to give advice to populations when they're maybe not being perceived as acting in the way that they should. I think that in terms of the issues for why people in more deprived settings are not necessarily having higher levels of vaccine uptake that we would like to see, there are issues around access.
Sorry, I think your sound's going. No, we can't hear you.
We'll try somebody else.
Sorry, we'll just move. Madam Fraser, would you like
to? Yeah, sorry, Dr. Loden, I think we're losing your sound. Can I maybe bring in Dr. Williamson, maybe to get her perspective on this?
Speaking specifically about whether we should make vaccine compulsory, I would echo what other contributors have said so far, and really building on the first evidence session this morning, a really big factor in all of this is about trust and about who you as an individual or as a community really think you should believe and who you should therefore, if you have to trust and you have to believe before you will then take action. So I, from my perspective, I would suggest that compulsory vaccination would be really challenging, because I think it would definitely drive some people to increase their uptake. I think for the sort of communities that we're wanting to sort of focus on this morning, I don't think that is a good reason to do it. And I think, if we're going to think about the kind of, why is it not? Scottish Government has made a commitment to move towards being a trauma-informed nation, and some of the principles of trauma-informed practice are that you always work collaboratively with people, you always you never tell a person what to do, and in a healthcare setting, and this is a healthcare intervention, and I think that's one of the things that we have to be really, really thoughtful about. And, Carrie, when she was starting to talk there, was mentioning, we have precedents here. We have other things that we can draw on. And I think it's really important that, across history, people have not taken up offers of healthcare, which this is. It's an offer of healthcare, unless they feel it's right for them and it's going to be a benefit to them. And I just wanted to mention, while I'm on, the sort of wider context for this, because, although we may all be forgetting this, there was a world before COVID, and there will be a world after COVID as well. And I wanted to specifically mention some of the research that I led on, which is about missingness in healthcare. And me and my team did a large-scale epidemiological study in Scotland before COVID hit, looking at patterns of missed appointments across healthcare. And our focus was in general practice missed appointments, but we also looked across the healthcare system. Now, this was a study of a sixth of the population of Scotland, and 19% of people had missed two or more GP appointments in the preceding, on average over a year of the preceding 3 years. So, this is not, that COVID and vaccination and all the issues that we're having to grapple with now do not happen in a vacuum. People have a history with their interaction with healthcare, and we have to really think about that, and we have to really consider what that means for going forward. And I'll stop talking now, and I'm happy to come back in to talk about what it is that we think would work to address that.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move to Alex Rowley, who's joining us remotely. Alex, do you have any questions for the panel?
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I think in terms of what Dr. Williamson was saying there, I think it would be good at some point for us to talk to Dr. Loon and Dr. Williamson about how GP services are raised. We have raised as a committee before the Newcomb model, for example. So that's perhaps something to come back to, but specifically for those two GPs, could I ask, in terms of communities that are hard to reach, I mean, is it a practical thing to say that we should be able to put in place training that would support local people within those organisations with the correct supervision to be able to deliver this programme, given the urgency that we face with this latest variant? And I think we're in for a really difficult few months. There is something urgent about trying to get as many people vaccinated as possible. Could I put that to Dr. Loonan, if the computer's working?
Dr. Loonan's back. She's got a new headset, so sound should be all right. No, I'm sorry. We're still having problems with your sound.
All right. Dr. Williamson, then.
think, you know, we've got existing people trained up to deliver vaccines, and I know there's been a huge sort of further recruitment campaign to increase that again. We also, and we heard this morning in the first evidence session, we've also got an amazing amount of fantastic people and communities who are connected across the communities of Scotland, you know, whether that be with our ethnic minority communities or in areas of high socioeconomic deprivation, and there's often a great overlap with that. You know, so if I was running this, I would be thinking, right, okay, we've already got people trained to do vaccinations. It's not actually about giving the vaccinations that's the issue. It's about getting them to people who still need to be vaccinated. It's about helping people overcome their vaccine hesitancy. How do we do that? We've heard, you know, and I absolutely agree with this, it's about people who are trusted and the people who have ongoing relationships with individuals and with communities. So you get people who have ongoing relationships out there acting as community champions, get them onto national TV, get them out and about in local communities, and you maybe even have to have them accompanying vaccinators who going out into localities, whether that be through buses, whether that be through chaplain and doors. We've had to do this across the health service for many, many years. We do this in inclusion health settings. It's about chaplain doors. It's about meeting people where they're at, and it's about helping people understand and move towards a place where they feel that the vaccine is the right thing for them, and then being able to give it.
So do you not think that there is a capacity problem, because politicians are telling us that it will be a tall task to be able to deliver for all over 40s the booster by the end of January. We see more and more young people coming on. There needs to be decisions made there. So do you believe the capacity is there to do all that and manage the health service through what is going to be a very difficult few months?
Absolutely, and you and we are loving that difficulty right now. But no, I think what I'm saying is, I think on balance, it's better to think about increasing capacity amongst the groups of people who've already been targeted as vaccinators. So, you know, retired staff who maybe work part-time, who are able to increase their sessional commitments. I'm not saying take people away from mainstream services. Talking about that, and I absolutely, you know, absolutely recognise there's a capacity challenge, but to at this point to suddenly switch and say, right, okay, let's train up lay people to vaccinate, it's possible, but we know from evidence in other countries where, you know, there is a long history of community health,
I can't hear speaking.
Health interventions, that's not the sort of capacity that you can upskill quickly.
Okay, I'll leave it at that, convener. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Can I move on to Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. I'm going to just move on a little bit from my colleague's questioning there around that vaccine hesitancy within the groups that we are discussing just now. And I'm wondering, within that hesitancy, is that inertia, if you like, the perceived difficulty in accessing a vaccine, and that perhaps vaccines are just seen as another issue that needs to be dealt with among so many other issues that the people we're discussing are facing. So with that question, is that, as Alex Riley said, do we need to take vaccines to the public rather than wait for the public to come to the vaccines, and we can overcome where most people seem to be getting their knowledge from is this social media, this fake news, which is undermining trust. Is that the approach we really need to be doing? I'll take that. Can I ask Derek Holliday that question, if I could?
Certainly. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much. I guess we've talked a lot about trust, and I guess people and environment. I think that's the key component to taking that risk, to putting yourself outside your comfort zone. But we need to focus on place-based approaches. All those relationships are in the community. It's family, it's friends, it's peer networks. But it's also those local health members that you see for your well-being, the pharmacy, spiritual and faith and recovery networks. That's where the trust is. We think about transport poverty, and we're having a conversation where we're sending people for a life-saving vaccine without actually assessing whether they can actually afford to do that. Who's going to take care of their kids in a lockdown? Who's going to support the members of family that they've got caring responsibilities? So, when we're looking at vaccines, if we look at the end of the journey, they're a lot more based in the community when they were in the first half. I remember the first year, unless you drove, you couldn't get a vaccine because it was specifically geared towards those who could drive. So anything we're trying to build trust, we need to have it in the community where the trust is, where the relationships are, where people feel safe, but also thinking about travel, poverty, babysitting, caring duties and responsibilities, and also mental health and anxiety for people who are scared to leave their homes still because the messaging hasn't targeted them. And also focusing more on the younger generation and adding them to the priority group. They were left at the end of the entire pandemic, and now we're wondering why we're struggling for this group and community to uptake the vaccine. We didn't communicate to them, we didn't give them trust, and the media attacked them through the lockdown. So as we move into the next phase, I think we should add them to the priority group and show them that they're part of our society and not a disconnected part that seems to be the one that's driving this when everybody has that responsibility.
Thank you. I wonder if I could bring in Hilda Campbell into that question as well, please.
Hi, I think it's just echoing what people have said about recognising what the barriers are and how they can be overcome. And certainly the anecdotal evidence I have is there are more people willing to take the vaccine than not. But as already been mentioned, it can be things like the person's a carer, they can't get out. They may live in a property where there's a communal area that mail's left, so they don't actually see their appointment letter. The transport. Sometimes you've got people who have been given a vaccination appointment maybe 18 miles from where they live, which is two or three bus journeys depending on the route that they're on. Whereas if they maybe just checked what's the postcode of the person, where's our nearest vaccination centre, which is what people have already been saying, is around how do we take the vaccine to people. But I think it's building on what works. It's about values and attitudes. If we shine a light of the positive response the people of Scotland have had to dealing with COVID, and they have, then other people who may be reluctant will be inspired by that and want to join in. Whereas if we do go down the route of mandatory vaccinations, that could actually undo an awful lot of goodwill and make people feel very hesitant and further enhance the scaremongering, if you like, that there's some big experiment that we're all being involved in. So I think, yes, take the message to people, recognise where people are, and that actually the vast majority of people do actually want to take the vaccine. And sometimes the reasons for not are very valid. They've got other health conditions and they're concerned, is that going to make it worse? So going into communities, local contacts, building up a rapport, keeping the message simple, I think would make the difference.
Just to finish that line of questioning, then to take it to its ultimate conclusion then, Do we know those who haven't taken the vaccine? Should we be approaching these people to ask them their opinion and why they haven't taken the vaccine? And then in that sort of respect, we're able to then reassure them that the vaccine is a safe way to protect themselves, and then offer them that vaccine locally, basically. I think that's really where we're getting to. Can I ask Dr. Andrea Williamson that particular question, please?
So yes and no, I think, is the answer to that question. So I think the important thing, though, is that this doesn't come across as a criticism. I think one of the really key things we have to do is suspend moral judgment, because I do feel that that is creeping into a lot of the public discourse on this matter. I think we have to be able to approach people and say, we really want to support you the best we can to meet your to be healthy. We think that we would like to offer you COVID vaccination. Let me, tell me, what are your worries? What are your concerns? What are your worst fears? It absolutely could not be a, you've not had the vaccine, can you answer that? Answer this questionnaire about what's going on. But I think one of the other key things that we've heard from many of the contributors so far this morning is that can't be an impersonal approach. It needs to be an approach from someone in that person's life that they trust and that they will listen to, and that they will accept that from. You know, we know over many, many years, and public health colleagues know this, that when really simple things, and that's one of the reasons why the vaccine appointment letters are blue. But whenever we send letters out and we send them out in brown envelopes, we know that people by and large throw them away because they think they're bills. And we know that people are worried about official headed note paper coming in. You know, so that, yeah, stop talking there.
Okay.
Thank you. Can I move on to John Mason, please?
Thanks. And yes, I was going to start with Derek Holliday as well, if that's okay. I think we've long had a problem with younger men especially, but men in general, not engaging with the health services across a whole range of things. So it's not just about the vaccine. I mean, do you think there's a particular problem with the vaccine and men, say, not getting involved in poorer areas? I represent the East End of Glasgow. And is that a longer term problem rather than just the vaccines?
Thank you. I'm from the East End of Glasgow as well. I think we have many issues in this area. Male population and toxic masculinity makes it very difficult in the west of Scotland for us to deal with emotion, which has quite often historically come from our upbringing. But in these communities, when I was homeless 4 or 5 years ago, food poverty, energy poverty, rent poverty, debt collectors, travel poverty, phone data poverty, internet poverty, mental health, these are all the things that come first in a poor area, rather than focusing on a vaccine, unless that message is in my community. It's from someone who I can trust. It's easy, it's accessible, and I don't have to go out my way, because this part of just living life to life, it's consuming me. So we're looking at the deprivation areas and access. We really need to be in that community. We really need to give time. We need to do town halls where we can sit in the community and sit with our expert panel and community members and talk until we can't talk anymore. So everybody gets to ask every single question they can think of. They haven't had that in any television where we've sat down and had communities and actually unwrapped the vaccines and what it meant and the process and the details, and having a whole day programme set out for the country so they could ask their questions to really understand what's going on. I don't believe we should be mandating people to do something, because that's a measure of we haven't done our job right. We can't do one size fits all for everyone. So we need to be more specialised and tailored, and we need to be in those communities and understanding what those needs are. We can't do it from afar, and we really need to connect with third sector organisations and health settings to really get the proper partnership so we can get the whole person view.
So, I mean, you're suggesting that some people have questions and they're just not getting the opportunity to ask them and have them answered. But do you not think there's just some people who are just, you could, you know, be there all day to answer questions and they just wouldn't engage, that they're just not wanting to engage, as you said, the kind of male traditional view?
Yes. Yes, but we're focusing on that when we're, if we're honest, not every single person in the world will have a vaccine. So not every single person in England will have a vaccine, or Wales or Ireland. We're never going to get to 100%. So we're always going to have a percentage of people who will not take it for whatever personal choice. But I think the more we hit people and attack people and push people into it, I think we have longer damage for pandemics in the future. This is a situation of understanding how that impacts that person. It's understanding people's individual learning needs. We don't all learn from a picture or learn from a book. Some people use different styles to understand their information. Some people have more time to reflect to see how that impacts their life. So a booklet and a leaflet is very one-dimensional. As everyone said today, we need proper people speaking to those groups and communities that don't trust or not uptaking that medication, and really understand the real people they can connect with and identify with, who they can trust. Because only until we actually sit down with the individual groups, we can have lots of committees and we can presume, but we'll still be dealing with the issue that we're dealing with, is that the message is not getting to the groups properly. That's our responsibility, to be more flexible and adaptable, and we need to be more specialised and targeted.
Okay, if I could move on to kind of the same question, I don't know if it's just yourself, Dr. Williamson, from the deep end side of things now. We have got Dr. Lunan back. We'll try her again. I mean, is there a particular problem? I mean, I'm a fan of the deep end kind of movement or whatever. Is there a problem with contacting men, younger men especially, in poorer areas, getting them involved in the health service? Is that just part of, is that why this is all happening, and it's not specifically for the vaccines?
Can you hear me okay just before
yes,
I start?
That sounds great.
Right. Thank you. So I'm not sure I fully heard the whole question. It was about particularly targeting younger men, is that right?
Yes, my kind of question to Mr. Holliday, so the same for you, is that I think the health services have generally struggled to interact with men, younger men in poorer areas. It's not just about the vaccine. Or is there a particular problem with the vaccine?
I mean, I think, as I was trying to say at the start, the COVID vaccine rollout and the demographics that we've seen have very much mirrored previous vaccine rollouts. There are specific practical issues, I think, around vaccination for younger men living in poorer communities
in being able to get to the mass vaccination centres. So general practice was involved in vaccinating people over the age of 75 and people who were shielded. And all the other vaccines largely have been delivered through mass vaccination centres, which requires you often to be able to drive, because a lot of people are very fearful of public transport, to have secure employment that lets you away. And a lot of our patients that we've spoken to have struggled because they've been matched to vaccine centres that are quite a long way away from where they live. So it makes it very difficult for people to attend the vaccine appointments that they're allocated. And then to be able to change the vaccine appointments, you need to either get through on a phone line, which is incredibly busy, or go through the NHS Inform website, which can also be challenging for other reasons. So I think there are practical issues that have made it difficult for people to be vaccinated.
Okay, thanks for that. Maybe I can come to Professor Quinn on the same theme, although I was going to ask you another question as well, which was, you know, there was some suggestion earlier on that it shouldn't be just age that we used for vaccines, but clearly people in more deprived areas, you know, are experiencing older life issues earlier on. And I just wonder if you agreed with the JCVI that they were as rigid as they were on purely age.
I was really aiming at Professor
Quinn to let him in. Sorry.
That's, well, I answer you both, but you're the first question first.
Yes.
Or
yes, yeah. That'd be great.
So in terms of your initial question, I think all the contributors have talked about the issue of trust. There's obviously, I think major issues within certain communities about trusting services. And I think we have to look at ways to build trust. And that's partly about removing barriers to access. It's about more active and assertive outreach. I think it's also about more lived experience involvement in designing services as well. I think Hilda mentioned at the beginning about lived experience panels. I think there's some quite creative and innovative work around how do we bring the value of lived experience into service design. Derek Holliday's done a lot of work on this. We've got a partnership that's trying to do that. So I think you know, looking at ways of building trust and bringing that lived experience dimension into service design, I think is very important. In relation to your second question, to be honest, I've not got particular expertise in that. I wonder if it's better, you know, obviously Dr. Luna wanted to come in, but I think my sense is we do have to be a bit more flexible because, you know, in relation to excluded communities, I think, you know, using age as the only criteria probably doesn't make sense. We need to think about, you know, communities that are very excluded and people experiencing homelessness and other communities. We need to think about how we reach those communities. And so I would think being flexible in the criteria is probably important, but perhaps Dr. Luna wants to come in and respond.
Okay, I think also Dr. Williamson wanted to come in. Well, I'll let Dr. Williamson come in first, if we've got time for that.
Yeah, so I suppose I was going to come back to the sort of the previous question about young men and living in socioeconomically deprived communities. And I suppose it's to try and pull us back to the principles of this. And it's the idea that actually, if we're not effectively managing to meet the health needs of our group within society, that means that we're not doing our job right. That means that policy planning and healthcare delivery is not working effectively. It's not that we should be trying to problematise a particular group. I just wanted to say that, and I think, you know, thinking about the language that Derek was using there when he was talking about this, he was talking about understanding. So it's how do we better understand how to meet the needs of people, and I think, you know, that's where we need to be moving with this. And I wanted to talk as well that, you know, the principle that underpins all of this is that proportionate universalism. You know, we've had in lots of ways a really, really successful vaccine campaign because we've got really high coverage. People have pulled out the stops to help vaccinate, and people have really worked hard to get to be vaccinated. but we're now at the point where we have a proportion of people within our communities who are really struggling to get that. So we need to think, right, okay, we need to now think about the additional resource, the additional expertise that needs to be pulled in, and it's community expertise. And I absolutely agree about the lived experience element to this, aspect to this. I think that's really, really vital as well. I'm not wanting to preempt what Carrie's probably going to say, but I think we're probably going to say the same thing. I think that in terms of the issue of age being an important factor, we've got really strong evidence, people experience, poor health conditions, i.e. multi-morbidity, at a much younger age in socioeconomically deprived communities. It's one of the key drivers, from a health point of view, of the health equity gap. So, yeah, I would be saying, yeah, we need to be targeting younger people and more socioeconomically deprived communities. Thanks.
And if we have a final word from Dr. Lunan on this point.
Thank you. Yes, it was just to say that deprivation-adjusted age is really important here. It's that people develop the diseases of old age at least 10 to 15 years earlier in more deprived communities. And although the JCVI guidance did specifically allow flexibility to address health inequalities, unless there was clear guidance on how that could happen, I think there was quite a lot of anxiety about actually delivering that on the ground. And there needs to be clear public messaging about why there may be deviation from the JCVI cohorts, so that we don't see kickback or discrimination or stigmatisation. So it needs to be done in a very sensitive way. But I think we need to be guided by the evidence base and the needs of patients in those groups. So I would agree we need to take age into account for a future vaccine rollout.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. Can I move on to Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you, convener. I'm going to try just summarise what I'm taking out of what I've heard from you. It really concerns me the hashtag "We will not comply," because if it's "We will not comply," it demonstrates to me a real lack of trust. Carrie, you talked about government's moral authority. How far back are we now from where we were at the start of this programme? And Neil, you were talking about the restrictions on the unvaccinated and excluded groups. And I have to ask myself, if you're living as a homeless person, somebody who's a refugee, sexually exploited, how much community concern do you have for getting a vaccination? And I see all of these silos of problems. The other one I was going to talk about was that was raised by the Polish community. They want individual face-to-face GP appointments to persuade them that the vaccination is the right thing to do. I really struggle to see how we get all of these what look like small groups and tackle them in a way that we can actually get the maximum amount of rollout into this. But there's significant numbers of people who are just simply not getting vaccinated. So does anybody have a one-size-fits-all answer to that? Because I see lots of little problems that are creating a big issue. Can I start with yourself, Andrea?
Sorry. Yeah, I mean, it does feel quite overwhelming, for sure. I think, though, I think the thing that really struck me about the first evidence session, and is what we would be echoing in the second, is that the expertise of localism, so the connected communities, that is the key thing. And that's something that we have that's really fantastic in Scotland in lots of ways. We've got amazing community groups and voluntary organisations delivering really important services. And the sort of group this morning talked about how with a bit of extra resource, they would be able to help by being community champions to help reduce vaccine hesitancy and increase uptake. So that's one element. And the other element is to extend what has been done pretty well in some places. If you remember when, and I live in Glasgow, so when there was the big outbreak or bump in cases last year, there were buses available, and people, when I spoke to people were really appreciative of the fact that a bus was coming to some of the local secondary schools. that public health colleagues and the planning for it was actually quite visible. So it's you know, we've got the building blocks. It's just a case of getting local intelligence and local knowledge about what's going to work for specific communities. And there's a lot of intersectionality in that as well. So, you know, there's people from BME communities, you know, maybe have precarious work experiences, or they may be living in socioeconomically deprived communities, or they may not be. You know, it is really mixed. But local communities will be able to help us.
Thank you very much. Carrie, can I ask you the same question, please?
Yep, absolutely. I mean, I think there is no one size fits all. If there was, we would, I think we would probably be implementing that already. But I think the important thing is that we learn as we go and we tweak rollout as we go based on learning. I think we should never underestimate, in addition to what Andrea said about the importance of community networks and lived experience, we shouldn't underestimate the importance of relationships of trust. And I did listen into parts of the first session, and there was a very consistent theme coming across about people wanting to speak to people that they knew, that they could recognise, to have conversations where they could unpick some of the things that they were struggling with. And I think as a GP, I have felt very conflicted about general practice involvement in vaccination. I think at the very beginning, when we were involved in the over 75s and shielded group, it was a hugely rewarding thing to be doing. I think we all hugely enjoyed doing it. And vaccination has been largely taken away from general practice for lots of complicated reasons, but usually or essentially to do with workload and other priorities and lack of a workforce. But what I've found is that often you need to have serial conversations with people over a period of time to help them unpick why they're concerned about the vaccine. And I've been doing that now for the last 10 or 11 months. And often it will be a light bulb moment at some point, or a family member gets sick, or they're worried that they might have had COVID, and suddenly people will decide that they would like to be vaccinated. And at that point, you can plug them into the system where they can get the vaccine. There's pros and cons, but if general practice had the workforce and the resource, I think a lot of people would still prefer to be vaccinated in their surgery, and there's no getting away from that. It's difficult to operate opportunistic vaccine in general practice because they come in packs of 10. So once you open one pack, you need to be able to use them all to avoid vaccine wastage. But when we design and deliver single dose vaccines, I think it will make it much easier for general practice and community pharmacies to be able to deliver opportunistic vaccine to people who are in or coming in about a different problem and haven't been vaccinated, and that moment is now. I think there's a lot of different things that need considered.
Okay, that's an excellent point, and we will definitely carry that one. Hilda, can I quickly ask you to come in this as well, please? Hilda?
Hello, yeah. Thank you. I think for all, there's a huge problem, but if we could actually look at those common themes across all groups in terms of work, messaging, individual concerns, and I wonder whether or not, because we can become overwhelmed by everything that's happening and trying to find a solution for every single distinct group, if we actually look at the themes and then we bespoke the responses to those themes to the individual groups. So if we agree on an effective communication strategy, that's adapted depending on who that is being targeted to. And that includes the media, because sometimes the coverage in the media and the sheer plethora of experts who sometimes are saying, and I'm a health professional, and I sometimes find what's really being said here. So if you don't have any background, that can be really confusing. So having some sort of overall action strategy, which is recognising, okay, here's the barriers to work. What could we do about having a vaccination bus near areas where there's a lot of workplaces that people could come and get that done? What's the message, and how do we involve people who've had a positive experience? How do we also personalise it? So is there a capacity within NHS 24 or some other line that if someone has an individual concern about the vaccine, they're actually encouraged to phone And that can be available to people from multiple cultures that recognise the particular challenges they've got. And also to try and make it more of an event going for the vaccine. I tried this a few years ago, increase the uptake of the flu vaccine, Jolly Jab Day. Now, we didn't have COVID restrictions then, so maybe it wouldn't work the same way, but something where actually there's a social event here. I mean, in some ways, you've got a tour queue, you've got a public health opportunity, the likes of which you rarely would actually get. So it's something about making this good. And while I recognise there are some people who would want to get it from the GP, there's a lot of people who actually like going into a sports centre because it's non-medical, it's less threatening. So again, it's finding what suits different people, be it a bus, be it a community centre, be it at the GP practice, but recognising it would probably be practice nurses because GPs have got so many other things that's going on. So I hope that's helpful. But I think we look at the themes and then we target them.
Yes, and very helpful. Thank you very much. And Neil, can I quickly ask you that same question, please?
Yes, you've raised a range of challenges, Jim, in your introduction. And again, I'd be loath to a one-size-fits-all approach. But I think for me, what I found helpful is a human rights-based approach framework, you know, which I know is gaining more traction at a policy level and in health services. So, because I think what we're seeing is a denial of people's rights, particularly for excluded groups, you know, having that right to health. So. So I think having that human rights lens, I think it's important. And I think there's different aspects to that. I think it's about tackling stigma and discrimination that occur within communities and within services. It's removing barriers. It's trying to promote that lived experience voice within service provision. So I think, you know, Derek and I are part of this Inclusion Health Group at Public Health Scotland that fund the research that we've done. And I think having that human rights-based approach, I think, is important. And that includes things like people knowing the right to complain if they're not receiving a service. So that would be, I guess, my take on it.
Okay, thank you very much. Derek, I'm not going to come to you because I know we're very short of time and I know the convener does want to bring something else in. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. Just one important point I think we haven't raised today, and as the only woman on the committee and having three children and going through three pregnancies and every woman goes through a pregnancy trying to look after herself and the baby through the 9 months. So we do know that there's a hesitancy from women that are pregnant. Could I ask Dr. Lunan and Dr. Williamson, just very briefly, I know we are short of time, what can we do to encourage women that are pregnant to take up the vaccine, especially as we're going through winter, to protect themselves and their babies? Dr. Lunan, would you like to come in first?
Thank you. Absolutely. Yes, I think it has been difficult for pregnant women because the guidance changed a lot at the beginning and left people feeling quite confused and anxious. I think the guidance is now very clear, but the anxiety persists for longer than the change in guidance does. I think that nothing substitutes hearing directly from pregnant women who've been vaccinated. You know, seeing people like me having a vaccine and feeling confident around it and being and having access to resources that are easy to understand, that are relevant, that are available in lots of different languages. I know that there are lots of really good resources on the Royal College of Obstetrics website and on the NHS Inform website, but that doesn't substitute an additional conversation if that's needed with either midwives or with GPs. So I think we need to make ourselves available to people who are worried. I think we need to know where people can find good information, and I think we need to recognise that there was a lot of confusion at the beginning and understand why people might still feel anxious about it.
Thank you. Can I bring in Dr. Williamson, please?
I don't have anything to add to that. I think that was a comprehensive and excellent answer.
Great. Thank you very much. I'm just going to bring in Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. I've got a very specific question really to Derek Holliday. I think one of the groups we haven't really focused in on now here is those who are caught in homelessness and caught in addiction. How do we reach out to those specific communities and bring them into the fold, if you like, and make sure that they're offered vaccination along with everybody else?
I guess we need more place-based health settings with multidisciplinary services that contain everything that that person would need in one day, rather than the subway experience where you're constantly travelling to try and get different aspects of your health, well-being, finance, security, information, your rights. So like the Simon Community Hub that's in Edinburgh and Glasgow is a perfect example. We should have them in every deprived area. So it's a one-stop shop. We're stopping people going around 14, 15 services when they're in the worst state of their life, so trauma-induced, and we're asking them to do all these tasks. Have a service that's in the community, it's measured by staff from both health and lived experience, where compassion, non-judgment and dignity is the foreword, and give people the space and trust so that they can make the decision to trust a service rather than that service forcing them to trust them. During the lockdown, all the services closed. That face-to-face contact, that ability to deal with the other aspects of our life that isn't health, lies on these services, and it literally is life and death. These become more priority than a vaccine. So there's a balance there. But I think we need to move all our services to a place-based approach. We should stop asking people to travel for their health. It's not a free health system then. We should be able to get everything we need from our community, and that's where we build long-term trust, long-term relationships, and people can start to manage their own life system rather than currently we've got people moving here, there and everywhere to see doctors that they don't see the following week or the following month. So we've got a consistent trail for majority of services where we can't build that relationship. So if I can never build that relationship with a professional that manages my health, how do I ever feel safe to discuss my trauma, find out what options and choices I have, and how do I move that forward with support?
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That brings us to the end, and I'd like to thank all the witnesses for their evidence this morning and giving us their time. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing, and the clerks will be happy to liaise with you on how to do that. The committee's next meeting will be the 16th of December, when we will take evidence from the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID recovery on coronavirus Discretionary Compensation for Self-Isolation Scotland Bill and a ministerial statement on COVID-19 and subordinate legislation. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning. I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and for this meeting to move into the private section. Thank you.